It's a beautiful sunny day. And one of the two water wheels is actually turning. We're lucky with the weather and we're lucky with the watermill.
A bit hard to see, but the gate has been opened. And the water is flowing
with quite some force and pushing the paddles on the water wheel.
So once the water current starts flowing, you can understand that the water wheel will start turning. But it will not turn fast immediately. It will very gradually pick up speed.
And this is like a coil. If you put a current through a coil, the current will not start flowing immediately. It will also very slowly pick up speed. And here the energy is stored in the momentum of this huge water wheel. In the case of the coil, the energy is stored in the magnetic field.
Totally different principle, but it works exactly the same way.
Here on the other inside, you can see part of the mechanism that would be driven by the watermill. And in this case, it presses linseed oil out of linseed.
Probably too dark inside, but let's try.
Yeah, okay. These two giant wheels roll around and actually press the linseed. But not today. Here we are inside of the watermill on the other side where the wheat is being ground. But it's been disconnected from the grinding things. Because there's no wheat to grind today. But the watermill turns anyway.
So to remind you again, the lake corresponds to the capacitor in the electronic world. The water wheel corresponds to the coil in the electronic world. The energy is stored in the momentum of the water wheel or in the magnetic field of the coil. The gates are the MOSFETs, which can be opened and closed. This one is open, so water flows, pushing onto the water wheel. This gate is closed and no water flows.
And on the other side, beyond the watermill, we see the second lake, which will be the second capacitor on the output of our circuit.
Today I'll try to explain the buck converter. This is the brother of the boost converter. It works in a very similar way, but different. It is a bit harder to understand than the boost converter, therefore I did the boost converter first. Please watch the video until the end. After that, you'll understand the buck converter. Let me try to explain all the different components. We start at the top left corner where the water enters. You can think of that as a tap which feeds into the system. It's our power supply. Then on the beginning, we have a big tank for water, which I explained before is our capacitor. And you can think of it as a box or tank with a balloon in it, which can fill with water. Once it is full, it's full. It cannot expand bigger than the box surrounding it. So in the water sense, it corresponds to the capacitor in the electronic sense. Next up, we have a switch, which is here, which we can open or close. Yeah, if it's closed, no water can flow. If it's open, the water can flow. For the sake of explanation, in the beginning, we close this off. Here we have our old friend, the water wheel, which can spin. Yeah, if water flows here, the wheel will spin. Think of the watermill. The wheel is big and heavy, and it cannot start turning quickly. Yeah, it will slowly pick up speed. And on the other hand, once it has speed, it will only slowly lose the speed. Then on the other side, on the output side, we have another capacitor, another balloon in a box, which can buffer the water and keep the pressure constant. In this situation, the water flows from the power supply this way through a switch past the water wheel. Will fill the balloon initially, but once it's full and keeps the pressure, the water in the balloon will stay more or less the same and out of the system. So in this initial situation, the circuit will not really do anything. Whatever water goes in flows past the water wheel and goes out. If we remove this, all the water will just flow down here. And here is the ground. So you have to imagine that this feeds into an infinite supply of water. There's a huge puddle or a lake, or it doesn't really matter, but it's the groundwater, you could say. But we don't want the water to flow straight down there, so we have a valve here. We put a one-way valve, which only allows the water to flow upwards. But there's absolutely no reason for the water to flow upwards, so the water will flow this way, this way, this way, this way, and set the wheel turning. So how does this change the voltage? Let me try to explain. First, what happens when we close the valve? In the initial situation, the valve is closed, the water wheel is stationary, and no water is flowing at all. Then when we open the valve, water starts flowing this way past the water wheel and out, and slowly the water wheel will start turning, but it will pick up speed after a little while. Once the water wheel has reached full speed, the magic starts to happen. We close this valve, but now what happens? The water wheel is still turning and pushing the water along here. But this bit is closed, so the water cannot come from there. So instead, the water is pulled up out of the ground through this one-way valve. It can flow in this direction. Yeah, so the water is pulled out of the ground upwards and is fed in this direction as well. The water wheel will slow down, of course, because it is losing its momentum. It's putting all its energy into drawing the water up from the ground through the valve and out. Once this starts slowing down, we open the valve again. The water wheel picks up speed again, and once it has speed, we close the valve again. And again, the turning wheel will pump water up from the ground. So you can understand that here the pressure will be lower than here, because work is being done to set the wheel turning. But the flow of water here will actually be bigger than what goes in here, because the water coming out here only comes from here when the valve is open. But when the valve is closed, the water current coming out here is actually coming from the ground. So in terms of current, you can understand that here we have a higher voltage that we're turning into a lower voltage, but we can actually get a higher current out than what we're putting in. This way, the efficiency can be relatively high. In this design, the function of this initial balloon or water tank or capacitor is very important, because the moment you open this, a lot of water will flow suddenly. And if you close it, this will stop again. So in opening and closing this, you would be putting an enormous strain on the supply of water normally. So that is picked up by this capacitor here. Without this capacitor, yeah, the water supply would have a lot of problems feeding a lot of water quickly. And the current here can be higher than the maximum current here, because it comes from the capacitor, which is what you want, because you want this wheel to spin as fast as it can go. The faster the water flow, the faster the wheel will spin, the more energy we're storing in the water wheel. This way we can also understand why the most seen wrong explanation on the internet is wrong. In that explanation, they essentially ignore the valve and they essentially also ignore the water wheel. Yeah, they pretend this is not here. This is closed. They ignore the water wheel. And they say, here we put 12 volts, high pressure water, and we just open and close and open and close and open and close and open and close the valve all the time, which will yield a lesser pressure here. That is true. If you would put 12 volts here, or 12 units of water pressure, and you would open and close the valve all the time, then if you time that right, you would get 5 volts here. But yeah, the amount of noise on that power rail would be completely horrible. Even with a huge capacitor here, you would not be able to solve that. Because whenever this is closed, all the energy would have to come from the capacitor. And when it is open, the energy would come from there again. And you'd have to fill the capacitor up. So the bursts of current would be ridiculously high. And when this is closed, the poor capacitor will have to supply the entire current, which is not really possible. This would have to be a very, very big capacitor. And in the end, the whole circuit would have big problems. Let's now change our circuit from the water world into the electronic world. So one by one, we'll replace all the components for their electronic equivalent. First off, we change this balloon for a capacitor. The capacitor is connected to ground. The valve already is a diode, but now we can say it's a diode. It allows the current to flow that way, but not that way. We change our switch for an electronic switch. In this case, a MOSFET. We change our output water tank for a capacitor, the output capacitor, and we change the water wheel into a coil. So again, everything stays the same. The moment we open the MOSFET, the current will flow through here, into the coil. The coil will resist the movement of the current, just like the water wheel resists the movement of the water, but slowly the current will pick up. In the case of the water wheel, the energy is stored in the momentum of the water wheel. There, it's a big heavy mass slowly turning. In the case of the coil, the energy is stored in the magnetic field. But it works the same way. The current continues flowing. We have our output capacitor to filter out any ripple on the voltage here. The capacitor on the input is called a time capacitor. It is responsible for being able to supply a huge current quickly. So the current is flowing this way. The water wheel is picking up speed. Yeah, the coil is starting to allow more current to flow through until it reaches its saturation point, which corresponds to the maximum turning speed of the water wheel. In the case of the coil, it reaches saturation. Beyond a certain point, no more magnetic field can be stored in it. It's full. Then we close the MOSFET. The current no longer flows here. But the current here, because of the coil, because the water wheel keeps pushing the current through, the coil keeps pushing the electric current through, it can no longer come from here because the FET is not conducting. So it draws the current from the ground, the electrical ground in this case, up through the diode, through the coil, and out of the circuit. The output capacitor buffers the voltage because it is switching, of course, so you need the capacitor here, but you almost don't. It's not really part of the necessary circuit. But the input capacitor is very, very important. Without this, it will not work very well. If you're working on repairing MacBook motherboards, or any motherboards for that matter, you might be saying, but wait, A buck converter does not look like this. I've never seen the diode, and there's always two MOSFETs. So in this case, we have the diode here, and about half the time the current is flowing through this diode. The problem with the diode is that it has a voltage drop. So 0.7 volts would drop across this diode. And a problem with the diode would be that not only is there a voltage drop, but the current is probably very, very big. So this diode would be dissipating an immense amount of energy. So instead of the diode, we put a MOSFET. The MOSFET, of course, does not work like a diode at all, but we can drive it. We know when it should be closed because we know when this one is open. Whenever this one is open, the current is flowing like this, and we want this one to be closed. But then the moment we close this one, we need this one to be open. So the circuitry driving this opens the one and closes the other, or opens the other and closes the one. And because it's driving this one, it knows exactly when to drive that one as well. The only problem is that you want this one to open as soon as possible after you close this one, but not too fast. Because if both are open at the same time, you're essentially creating a short circuit across the power supply to the ground, which would be absolutely catastrophical. On the other hand, the moment that you open this top MOSFET, you don't want it to take long for the bottom one to open. Because when both are closed, the water cannot flow, and you would be losing the energy from your water wheel without actually being able to feed water out. When designing this circuit, it is important to understand the characteristics of your two MOSFETs, because the timing is quite critical. So in driving the gate, the gate acts like a capacitor. So depending on the current with which you're driving the gate, it will open and close quicker or slower. And this you have to have under control, because you want this one to open immediately after closing that one, and vice versa. So whenever in a buck converter, where you see two MOSFETs, a high side and the low side MOSFET in series, going from the power supply to the ground, it is important that when you swap one of them out because it's broken, that you use the same one. If not, your timing might be off, and it could result in the new MOSFET that you just soldered in killing itself or the other one very, very quickly. But remember, in the end, it's easier to imagine like this. This way you don't have to drive it, and it does exactly what it should, except in the real life it will also dissipate a lot of energy. I hope this makes the working of the buck converter a little bit more clear. If you have any questions, feel free to write them in the comments down below. Thank you for watching. I hope you now understand how a buck converter works. If you haven't seen it already, please also watch our video on the boost converter. It works the same way, and again, there we also show the watermill. Remember that you can always, always, always think of an electronic circuit as working with water. In some cases, it's easier to understand with water. In some cases, it's easier to understand as electronics. But because of the physics, it always works the same way. Please visit our website, www.cmizapper.com. We make lots of products that are useful for people who repair computers. Thank you for watching, and consider subscribing to this channel.